before I introduce them, I'd like to speak briefly about the Applied Ethics Institute and what it is that we're supposed to be doing here, as well as a little bit about the philosophy department. So the Applied Ethics Institute is designed to be an academic center, but with a focus on engaging in matters that are of paramount importance to the public. The thought is we want to engage in things that are both timely as well as things that matter to people outside of the academy. So I think having a conversation about diversity and how we ought to value diversity is especially important today. These are the sorts of conversations that a lot of philosophers often have. So if this is something that is of interest to you and something that you might wish to pursue further, please don't hesitate to let myself or anyone in the philosophy department know. We'd be happy to have a conversation with you about majors or minors or just our work more generally. Okay, without further ado, Professor Muldoon is here from SUNY Buffalo. Before that, he was a senior research fellow at Penn. He's also a core author of the 2015 World Development Report at the World Bank. He is the author of Social Contract Theory for a Diverse World in 2016. So please join me in welcoming Professor Muldoon.
Thanks very much. So today I'm going to talk about what I'm calling the paradox of diversity. And so just to motivate this a little bit, a lot of my work focuses on diversity and why it's a good thing and why we should all want to be motivated to be around lots of people that are different from ourselves. But we're in an interesting moment right now where we're seeing a really large reaction against diversity across the West. So in the UK, the Brexit vote was largely centered around concerns around immigration and loss of English culture. It was pitched as the resurgence of what's called Little Britain. In the US, a really good predictor for vote share for Trump was attitudes towards immigrants, minorities, and international trade. We also have a rather open alt-right movement broadly advocating for white supremacy. In France, the National Front, which is traditionally a post-Nazi organization, received 34% of the national vote for the presidency. Just last week or two, the Freedom Party of Australia, which is again a right-wing populist organization, won 51 out of 183 seats in the legislative elections. It's the first time they've ever had a seat in Austria. They got 51. And so what I want to think about is, where does this leave advocates of diversity? How can we honestly argue that this is a good idea when there's such a big reaction against it? And so to give you a little bit a flavor for this, here are some real political ads. Let's see. This and this are both from Switzerland. This is from the SVP party. They're another right-wing populist group. And a not-so-subtle image, the white sheep are kicking the black sheep off of the Swiss flag. Translates roughly as for our safety. Here, it's saying, stop mass immigration as different colored hands are grabbing citizenship cards. This was put up all around the south of France by the National Front, saying neither veils nor burqas, with little prison bars across the face. There's lots of variants on this theme. This was one of the more common billboards that UKIP, the party most responsible for pushing the Brexit vote, used a swarm of people trying to come into the UK, and they say the EU has failed us all, let's break free of the EU and take back control of our borders. They won that vote. In the US, it's not too hard to find people that have gotten worked up about a more multicultural America. This is an image that you've probably seen from Charlotte. These guys are screaming things like, you will not replace us, over and over again. Then there's more academic worry that we can step back a little bit from the kind of not pleasant politics of the day, and we can think about how people go about talking about diversity in a more calm environment than just writing academic papers. And there's indeed two kind of lines of reasoning that are rather prominent right now. So one is a line of work that argues that diversity generates all kinds of benefits. So a really prominent voice in this is Scott Page's work. He and his collaborator Lu Hong proved a theorem about this around 15 years ago, showing that diverse groups of people do better than a homogenous group of people that are more able, that are more fully rational. So even when you reduce the level of rationality in the diverse group still performs better than the homogenous group. And then there's a whole bunch of empirical work that supports the claim that diverse groups outperform homogenous groups in a whole bunch of different kinds of tasks. Then there's another line of work that looks like it's at least in tension with that initial set of work. So there are kind of systematic findings that in diverse environments, social trust is lower. What I mean by social trust is just a notion of generalized trust with strangers. How much do you rely on assuming that strangers are being honest with you? How worried are you about your personal safety when you're walking around your neighborhood, that kind of stuff? People also in general report being a little less happy in a diverse environment. And one of the more prominent papers in this literature is by Robert Putnam in a 2000 paper, argues that he's found what he calls a hunkering down effect that drives down social capital, that is, your connections with others, your ability to bond and share values with other people. In essence, he shows that in more diverse environments, you're more likely to stay at home. You don't have to go out and about, you're less likely to join organizations, you're less likely to participate in civic affairs, that kind of stuff. So I'll run through how these two arguments are meant to work so we can see why they might be in some amount of tension with each other. Then we'll see what our options are. So the standard pro-diversity argument works like this. Theoretically, it's kind of obvious in some sense why two people that are very alike from each other don't benefit much from the other person. Because we're going to be good at the same kind of stuff and bad at the same kind of stuff. So a room full of philosophers are going to be really good at telling you all about the different formulations of Kant's categorical imperative. They're going to be pretty lousy at fixing your transmission. Because philosophers have a particular skill set, and the more impact in the room, the more likely they're just going to be copying the same set of skills that each other has. But if you care about anything other than philosophy, if you have a room full of philosophers, you're going to get into trouble pretty fast. Right? Those people just aren't able to help you with the things you care about. But more subtly, more importantly, the way that Scott Page and Lu Hong think about this, if the way you think about a problem and the way that I think about a problem are more or less the same, if we kind of categorize the world in the same way, if we rely on the same basic methods for approaching a problem, we're really, really likely to come to the same conclusion every time. But that means that having you there doesn't aid me in my efforts to solve the problem, because you're just replicating the thing that I would have done too. But if you and I come at the problem differently, if we categorize the world in different ways, if we rely on different techniques, then we're a lot more likely to catch each other's errors and provide a fuller picture of what's going on. So, diverse groups benefit from this idea that if you're different from each other, you're more likely, even if you're more likely to make mistakes, more likely one of you has gotten it right. If everyone's the same, if everyone's doing the same thing, while it might be the case that any one of you is more likely to be right in general, if we're assuming that homogeneous groups are just, the individuals are the best at what they're doing, they're still leaving off stuff that they don't know how to do very well. about it in a slightly different way. Imagine you can get a flu shot that works 90% of the time. That sounds great. And imagine you want to boost your immune system by getting another flu shot that also works 90% of the time but covers the exact same kinds of flu. There's no point in getting that second flu shot. But if you get a second flu shot that only works 30% of the time, which sounds pretty terrible, but it happened to cover the 10% of cases that the first one missed, you definitely want that second flu shot. Even if it is, in general, worse, it only can take care of 30% of the cases compared to the 90, you want it to get it, right? Because then you can get full coverage. Then you can get, you don't worry about the flu at all. So this basic concept isn't just used in kind of theoretical economics or social science. It gets used all over the place. So in the physical sciences, this basic thought is referred to as robustness analysis. So if you look at how the National Weather Service predicts the weather, they don't have one model of the weather that one computer runs a simulation, figures out what's going on. They actually, you can go to their website and see this, they have three distinct models that they rely on. And whenever they're going to make a weather prediction, they compare the results from those three different models and figures out where they're convenient. And so actually you can see every day on the National Weather Service's website a brief discussion of where the models agree and disagree and what we think we can derive from that information to figure out what our final judgment is. So this is quite common. Likewise, in climate science, there's a whole lot more than just three models that get fed into the same predictive program in an attempt to figure this out. This is also, as it turns out, how Netflix makes recommendations for you. So you might not remember this, but about 5 years ago, Netflix offered $1 million prize to any person or group that could improve Netflix's recommendations by 10%. This resulted in a massive amount of work of a ton of different people trying to figure out how to improve Netflix's recommendation engine. Basically, the better Netflix is at recommending things for you, the more likely you binge watch things on Netflix and keep paying them $10 a month. And the big breakthrough that people had, they were kind of maxing out at around 5% improvements, which wasn't going to get them much of a prize, was realizing that there wasn't going to be one way to do it. And so in machine learning, which is the area of computer science that's used in the background for this Netflix stuff, there's an area study called ensemble methods, or ensemble learning. And basically the way it works is, instead of trying to come up with one single algorithm that's really sophisticated that tries to figure out what you're going to like based on what you liked before, it's a bunch of really crappy algorithms. So it can be like, is Meg Ryan in this movie? Yes or no? Did you previously like things that Meg Ryan is in? If so, you'll probably like this movie, she's in it too. Or, how many bullets are in this movie compared to how many bullets were in movies that you liked before? And so on and so forth. These really dumb, very simple, what are called classifiers, ways of dividing movies up, then just basically all get a vote on whether they think you're gonna like this next TV show or movie. And the bigger the vote, the better the recommendation. And so, all of these individually are going to be awful. If Netflix only recommended movies to you based on whether Meg Ryan was in it or not, it's not going to do a very good job, unless you just love Meg Ryan. But otherwise, together, they perform way better and can computationally do this much faster than a really one very elaborate single algorithm can do. They outperform any individual algorithm by a fair margin. And this is just that same idea of diversity do it better than ability that Scott Pagan's talking about. So those are more theoretical arguments, but empirical findings in social science are rather consistent with this result. So there have been a lot of lab studies that compare kind of teams of homogeneous participants against teams of diverse participants, where diversity can be cached out in several ways. It might be ethnic diversity in one case, religious diversity, gender diversity, has been done in a bunch of different ways. And in general, what we find is that more diverse groups are better at solving like puzzles, whether they're physical puzzles or word problems or putting together erector sets and things like that. Or just generating lists of words that have some restrictions. So how many words can you come up with a second to last letter and is an N? Make a big list of those letters, of those words in 5 minutes, that kind of stuff. Or more complicated things like making predictions about future stock prices or future political events, or how much does a cow weigh that you take that you see, all those sorts of things. In general, diverse groups do a lot better than homogeneous groups. So, and not only do we find this in the lab, but we also find this in settings we might think have bigger real-world consequences. So actual firms tend to make more money when they're more diverse. So a big deal in the like the Harvard Business Ethics case study literature is Pepsi-Cola in the 80s decided that its strategy was going to be going after more minority market share. And so they made a big HR push to diversify their workforce. And as a result, they massively improved their economic performance. They got much larger market share. Their profitability went way up, and as a result, Pepsi is now a big corporate evangelist around diversity-centric HR practices. There's also been a number of rigorous academic studies that look at single firms that have multiple offices and look at the different levels of diversity across offices of the same firm and compare the profitabilities of those different offices. And systematically, we find that more diverse offices generate larger profits. So with real money, real world considerations, this stuff tends to bear out. But there's also this anti-diversity argument. So the two big hitters, so to speak, in this literature are Putnam 2007 and Allison 2003. And usually, if you're reading an op-ed piece or something like that, it's criticizing diversity, one of these two guys being the best. So Allison in 2003 argues that diverse populations, in this paper he's looking at an index of 150 countries and looking at, within those countries, what's the level of what's called fractionalization. So how do you measure ethnic diversity, or linguistic diversity, or religious diversity for an entire country's population. And then within country, different cities have different levels of these fractionalization levels. The more fractionalized, the more diverse. And what they find pretty consistently in this paper is that more diverse cities and more diverse countries tend to be worse at providing what are called public goods, so things that are jointly government provide via taxation, things like airports or lighthouses or police forces and that sort of stuff. And the reason for it, Allison argues, is that the more diverse you are, the harder it is to coordinate. So harder it is to cooperate with other people just because, one, you're more different from each other, and so you don't share a lingua franca or how to engage with each other easily without too much effort. But also, a big thing that makes this problematic is that the more diverse you are, the more likely it is you all want different things. So it's harder to agree on which set of public goods you even want. You know, do you want more schools or more prisons? Do you want more parks? Or do you want a bigger army? The more diverse you are, the less likely you're all going to agree on these kinds of questions. And so as diversity ramps up, the ability for citizens to provide themselves with things via government and taxation becomes harder. So the other big argument on this is Putnam 2007, which argues that diverse communities suffer from a loss of social trust. And what Putnam found so striking about this is that this is even true within your own group. So even within your own religious group or within your own ethnic group, you trust those people less than you would have you been in a more homogenous environment. You just, in general, are less trusting. You're less willing to join clubs, a thing that Putnam is very concerned about. You're not so willing to engage in civic life. You're less likely to go to town meeting, participate in local politics, all that kind of stuff. You're much more likely to stay at home and watch TV, basically, the more diverse the environment is. And so, systematically, we have this withdrawal from civic life, from local public life, and we have a reporting of just being less happy. And Putnam thinks that's largely because you're seeing fewer people and making fewer social connections. One of the things that reliably makes us happy is having more social connections. And so, in a more diverse environment, you have fewer of these things, so you become less happy and more withdrawn. The rub of this is that some of these findings we find in the pro-diversity literature too. So those diverse groups that those lab studies performed better than homogenous groups didn't like it. So the diverse groups, one, they thought they did worse than the homogenous groups. The homogenous groups reported doing great. They thought everything was fantastic and awesome, and they were just wildly successful. They weren't, but they felt really good about themselves. In the diverse group, they thought it was miserable, that they were failures, they did not achieve their goals, but they exceeded their goals in general. But they didn't like it. So they thought they did worse, they didn't like it, they didn't like the level of conflict in their group, and they thought less positively of the group members, both in terms of just they thought they were kind of jerks, and they thought they didn't perform it. Likewise, diverse firms that report higher earnings also tend to have, within firm, lower social trust than more homogenous groups. They also are a little less happy, and they also find working with their colleagues a little more difficult. These aren't huge effects, but they're definitely negative. So, this is a bit of a bar. Right? We find that diverse groups outperform homogenous groups on most measures we might care about in terms of productivity or anything like that. But they also seem to make people less trusting. They reduce people's happiness. They have more conflict. People just don't want to be in the diverse group. If you give them the choice, in general, people choose to be in a homogenous group, even though they perform worse than the homogenous group. They think they do better, and they like it more. And so the sort of interim conclusion that we can draw from this is that, well, diverse environments are better, but they're harder. So if you're in a diverse environment, if you're in a more diverse group, most outcomes that we care about are improved. But it's just a lot harder to be in that environment than one where you're more comfortable. And so we have to weigh these social gains from diversity in the form of, you know, in the stuff I've described here, production improvements, but at the cost of real loss of social cohesion and a level of personal comfort that goes away. So I think this can make some sense of backlash against diversity that we've been seeing in the West. So first, it's not that there's anything obviously wrong with finding value in one's community or your cultural group. That's not kind of morally bankrupt. It's not wrong to want to feel comfortable in your environment and not feel like you have to worry so much about how you're behaving or what you're saying or anything like that. That's totally understandable. Everyone likes to feel comfortable. And from everything we can tell, it really is true that being in a diverse environment takes more work. It's harder. It's harder to be empathetic with people that are different from us. There's robust social science backing that up. It's a lot easier to understand where someone's coming from if they're like you. So you have to do that much mental work to put yourself in a position and think about the choices they make. It's a lot easier in a homogeneous group to communicate with people because you have a lot of shared history or values or culture or whatever that just facilitates communication. It's less likely that you're going to make a mistake. And so when you're in a more diverse environment, you're, by definition, dealing with people that have a different background, bring to bear different kinds of evidence than you, have different sorts of values than you, potentially. And you have to figure out how to navigate that. That's just more difficult. And so what we find from this initial literature is, well, on the one hand, there's the obvious reason to be in the more diverse environment. You just do better. But there's also the obvious reason to be in the homogenous group. It's way easier. It's way more comfortable. So what do we do about this? Well, one option maybe is we can try to keep diversity, but make diversity easier. So maybe there's a way of focusing on how we can make diversity just less difficult to deal with, make it a more pleasant environment for everybody to be in. And this is often a suite of suggestions that people make. Well, focus on something like assimilation instead of a more multicultural ideal. So encourage people to be more, you know, the e pluribus unum idea. Out of many, we become one. Like we all slowly assimilate into a melting pot. And so then we, you know, we try to make us more like each other, largely based on kind of trying to find and expand on some broad set of social values that we all share. So political philosophy is like this sort of technique. Lots of people advocating for ways of accommodating new people as immigrants to the United States, focus on this idea, make people more like Americans. Make them more like the people who are already here. And then we can have diversity, but we're really Americans first. And so this is something really close to what France's national policy is, right? So you're French first. You can be whatever religion you want to be, or whatever ethnicity you want to be, so long as you're French. And you recognize your French identity as your primary identity. We don't have that French first kind of ideal in the United States, obviously. We don't have an American first ideal. But in France, it's credited with why France was most welcoming to Jews out of most European countries for a long time. So they said, sure, just be French, and then it's fine. We can think also in the US context, something like Irish or Italian integration. So it's hard to imagine now, but once upon a time, Irish and Italians were not looked upon so fondly by other whites in the United States. Irish people, you can find in the political ads for this, used to be depicted as subhuman. They'd be drawn as like apes with leprechaun hats. And Italians, I didn't know this until recently, that swarthy used to count as an ethnic category. You could like check on the census. And Italians were swarthy, they weren't white. But now, we just view Irish and Italians as just white people, right? We might think it's relevant on St. Patrick's Day or something like that, whether you're Irish or not, but otherwise, who cares? You're just one of the many different varieties of white European. And so, that is sort of a quasi-success story for the assimilationist sort of account of the United States. They used to be culturally distinct, now they're just American. So the goal of this approach is to manage diversity. It's trying to figure out how we can reduce the kinds of conflicts that diversity generates. And so we focus on these shared values, we encourage people to become more like people, such that the scope of conflict is just reduced. And in political philosophy, I think that we can see versions of this in what's called reasoning as citizens. So if you look at Rousseau in The Social Contract, he argues that what we need to do is if we reason as citizens, we put aside our individual interests, or our group affiliations, and we just think about what we need as citizens to engage on equal terms with other citizens, and what citizens need to engage with the state. So this strips out all of our private interests, all of our private differences, and focuses on the core thing that we all are. So John Walls does something quite similar, arguing that if we imagine ourselves as just the stuff that morally matters, namely our equal citizenship status, we can figure out the right ways of determining the rules of society such that we can all be different, but we're the same insofar as we share a core set of democratic values. And that's the thing that we focus on. So these strategies essentially try to kind of kick up a level of abstraction until we all start looking the same. And so explicitly what's going on here is just aiming to limit the scope for where diversity can cause problems. And then we use something like an account of liberal neutrality across different kinds of life or different social identities, such that you can kind of do that in your private life. But when you're engaging with everybody else, we're thinking about the rules that we all rely on for getting along with each other in society. We are just all citizens in the same way. So I don't think this approach works. This approach essentially asks us to manage our diversity by making us less diverse, by taking away the features that, in my mind, make diversity kind of interesting and important. And it concedes the idea that diversity is a problem to be solved rather than a resource. And another sort of worry that I think I have some evidence for is that if we reduce diversity in this sort of way, if we focus on some sort of assimilationist ideal, we might be getting rid of all the benefits that diversity gives us in the beginning. And then it's sort of self-defeating. We're just going back to being a homogenous environment where we do worse, but we feel happier doing it. And so we haven't achieved anything. So there's some big picture evidence to this effect, I think. So there's a bunch of economic history arguing that essentially assimilation and homogeneity lowers social innovation. And a really fascinating working paper, economic historian Eric Cheney, in a really cool paper called The Rise and Fall of Islamic Science, looks at several hundred years of the caliphate organized around Baghdad, and shows this phenomenal increase in state investment and eventual flourishing of philosophy, of science, of mathematics, of logic, where there are very large intentional efforts to get better in all these different fields for kind of a specific reason, namely at this time in the caliphate, it allowed for people of whatever religion to be there, but had sort of three mechanisms to encourage people to become Muslim. One was if you were a non-Muslim, you had to pay an excise tax, I think around 5% of your income. So there was basically a financial incentive for you to convert. The next step was you weren't allowed to convert out of Islam to something else, you only convert in, so this was a rationing effect. And then finally, they invested in arguments. They invested in science, they invested in philosophy, they invested in mathematics, they invested in logic to come up with arguments that weren't based on the Quran for why you should join the Islamic faith. They knew that they weren't going to convince someone by pointing to a book that a person didn't care about. They had to show how much more you could do and how much better it was to be a Muslim. So they showed off their scientific knowledge. They developed sophisticated arguments to argue for the truth of the Quran without having to rely on anything in the Quran itself. But once conversion to Islam was more or less complete, that state investment disappeared. There was quickly a rather large collapse in the production of scientific knowledge. And instead, the intellectual work, Cheney argues, was mostly around differing interpretations of the Quran and sort of internal arguments rather than external arguments. And so the caliphate went from the basically largest knowledge producer in the world to one of the least knowledge productive places in the world. Because basically they won. Right? They got what they wanted. They got religious assimilation. There's a sort of similar story with the Han conquest of China. Basically, economic historians argue that China was just too successful too quickly in being able to conquer a very large landmass, particularly on the conquest of China. And so once basically they won, all of the territory they cared about didn't have to innovate anymore. And so it became an increasingly bureaucratic environment that was extremely rigidized hierarchy. In fact, famously, China lost knowledge of what it had previously invented. You know, they discovered gunpowder, but Europeans brought it back to them. So they forgot to invent that. As well as several clock designs and a whole bunch of other things. And so China, well, John Stuart Mill talks about this in Liberty, went from this amazingly innovative place to this amazingly stagnant place. All because there was sort of no internal diversity driving any kind of competitive pressure to do better. Then a current economic historian, Joel Malkier, has offered a similar argument for Europe's success, particularly around the Industrial Revolution in the periods immediately preceding it. He argues, essentially, that Europe is full of small countries that are roughly on parity with each other that were constantly fighting, which generated lots of reasons to get better at technology and science, to better wage wars against your neighbors that would otherwise attack you. So a culture of innovation was developed largely on the back of both internal religious conflict and external ethnic conflict. And so in these three cases, in kind of big chunks of the world, what's going on is we have lots of evidence of different places in time for kind of different reasons of diversity. Diversity motivating a very large investment in innovation and knowledge production and discovery and kind of social responsiveness. But in the places where the diversity was driven down, it went away. That innovation and that dynamism died off. Where it succeeded wasn't because of any kind of European superiority, it was just rough balance of power between nations and armies. And a bunch of different versions of Christianity that decided it was a good idea to try to kill each other to figure out who was right. And so that stuff drove an immense amount of innovation. And so I think with that background, we can reconsider diversity's role a little bit. So the arguments I was giving you in favor of diversity in the beginning were focused on diversity having providing benefit due to complementarities. If we're different from each other, we're bringing different skills to bear, and when we cooperate with each other, we can do more stuff. It's just true, and kind of fundamental to any theorems in economics. It's better to have a wider range of skills in the marketplace. It's better to have diverse preferences in the marketplace. All those things generate complements such that we can cooperatively generate more stuff. It's also just fun to have different kinds of food. It's fun to have different kinds of art or music or books or whatever, rather than just one kind of thing. It's more exciting to be in that sort of environment. Likewise, Hongfei shows that this notion of cognitive diversity improves our ability to solve problems. All of these arguments rely on complementarity. Just when there's difference, they're not in competition, but they're rather helping each other out. But these, as I talked about before, these are benefits that are contrasted against the burdens of diversity. Namely, diversity generates conflict. Diversity increases our discomfort, and so on. But the thing that I think is important if we look at this wider scope of literature is what happens if it's the case that the burdens are part of the benefit? So that diversity generates conflict. might be a good thing for us. And so it's not that diversity is better, but it is also harder. Rather, this suggests that diversity is better because it's harder. Diversity generates benefits not just from those complementarities, but from the conflicts. So on this account, conflict is a virtue of being in a diverse environment. You want people to have disagreements, not murdering each other, of course, but you want people to constructively push those disagreements into social discovery. So if we look at those lab studies again, a reason why those diverse groups both did better and liked it less is because in those diverse groups, you're just way more skeptical when someone that's different from you makes a suggestion. You push them and you ask for their argument. You ask them for evidence. You ask for their reasons. When they're like you, you don't do that. You're like, yeah, that sounds right. And when we're in those environments, we just want to outperform people that we think are different from us. We like a little bit of competition. And so that skepticism paired with that kind of conflictual competition makes us better. We're in a more homogenous environment. If someone tells you things that you like to hear, you say yes to it. Right? It sounds great. This is, you know, how like fake news spreads on both the right wing and the left wing. It reports headlines that you really want to be true. So you say, yeah, sounds good. I'll share this with my friends, right? We all like this idea. So this headline's a new one. And then when we hear things from people that we like, we're just more inclined to think they're doing something smart and interesting because we like them already. And so, if it's, you know, conversant with our values, yeah, sounds great. If it's someone that we respect already, yeah, great, sounds good, we'll do that thing you just said. And that makes us overconfident. So we keep thinking, well, I said he had a good idea, and he said I had a good idea, so we must have both had good ideas. And so we're just gonna, you know, do great. But if we're in the diverse environment, well, she hated my idea, and I thought her idea was terrible. So obviously, we must have done it badly. But no, the critiquing was the part that made our ideas better, and it made them work better, and made us push harder to come up with the next idea. And so, if we try to squeeze out the conflict, we're taking away the benefit that diversity gives us. And so here's where I think we get a notion of the paradox of diversity. So if we eliminate the conflicts that diversity generates, we take away the benefits of diversity. But then we're still left with the problem in some sense. How do we get people to want to be in a more diverse environment in the first place? They're probably not going to believe you that it's better. Because it looks like we're in what a game theorist would call a social dilemma. It's easier and lower risk for me to be in a homogenous group, right? It's going to be easy to communicate in that environment. It's much more straightforward to coordinate. But there are a lot bigger social gains if I can manage the diverse environment. And so this is what's called the stack hunt in game theory. Where the kind of cutesy story of the stack hunt, which actually comes from Rousseau, that guy I was making fun of earlier. Basically, it's the following setup. You're two hunters, and you can either go off by yourself and hunt a hare, and you can do that by yourself and pretty much get a sure thing. Or if you figure out how to cooperate, you can together take down a stag, or a stag just has a lot more meat. Right? And so, there are two, what are called Nash equilibria. There are two stable states to interactions of this sort. One is cooperate, where we both decide to join in a stag hunt, because if I deviate or if you deviate, no one's made better off. But I can only worsen my payoff if I leave the stag hunt. Or the other one is we both defect, that is, we both go after hair on our own. because I can't unilaterally decide to go after a stack and be successful. So both of these are stable in the sense that once we're here, we're probably going to stay here. But what's interesting is these two equilibria have different properties that are important. So this one is what we can call payoff dominant. You, like, both parties get more. There's just more to be divided if we can end up in that situation. It's what's called payoff dominant. But down here, it's what's called risk dominant. If you're worried about failing, you should hunt here. If you're worried about whether you're going to successfully coordinate or not, hare hunting is the right thing to do. So it's not that hare hunters are necessarily jerks. It's that they're just risk averse. Hunting stag requires that you successfully cooperate with someone, and that depends not only on what you do, but what the other person does, and you can't predict necessarily what the other person is going to do. You have to kind of make that work. Whereas hunting hare, this is a solo exercise. You can be assured of your success. And so I think if we kind of take those lessons out of the stack and pull them back to this question of diversity and no diversity, it tells us that our story's a little mixed. So on the plus side, a diverse society really is an equilibrium outcome. This is a stable thing that we can achieve. Right? It's stable and it's better in some sense, right? It's better in that we can get more things. Once we have achieved it, we can believe that we're going to stay there. But getting there requires that people open themselves up to a risk of failure, a risk that is not going to work out. And I'll make this, I will also, it turns out a homogenous society is also in equilibrium, right? It's less prosperous, but it's easier and more comfortable. So it's less risky. We're less likely to run into problems in this environment because we can manage it better ourselves. So the challenge then is how do we go about embracing the risks of diversity? What can we do to make people want to be in this kind of environment? Because people can sensibly want to choose an easier way of life. We know we can't do that by just kind of mitigating diversity scope, smoothing over those rough edges, making it easier. The more we do that, the less diversity we become. We just become more of the same sense. So my best guess, and I'd love to hear any questions, what do you guys think of this, is my best guess is it's something like building up what John Stuart Mill thought of as our autonomy. So building up our capacities as individuals to navigate more complicated environments. These are skills that we can develop. They're just hard. It takes work to develop these things, but it makes interacting with people that are different from us easier the more we practice at it. So Mill thought of these as a capacity that's developed over time like a muscle. It's not a yes-no kind of thing, but a matter of degrees. And so this doesn't reduce our conflicts. It doesn't make us less diverse, but it makes us individually more capable of navigating or coping with or figuring out that diversity. And I think that this might do some work additionally to explain some patterns of support and resistance to diversity. So if you look at Pew surveys, in the United States, or look at surveys in the UK about the Brexit vote, or World Value Survey, or European Value Survey data about continental Europe. In general, people are more okay with immigrants, more okay with people that are different from them on a few fronts, when they're already in a diverse environment. So if you're already in a big diverse city, you tend to like diversity. Or you tend to at least not like it. When you're in a less diverse environment, you tend to be more scared of it. And that's not true, just true in the United States, it's true in Canada, it's true in the UK, it's true in continental Europe. that's a pretty robust finding. The other thing that points in this autonomy direction at least a little bit, though I think we should attenuate it a touch, is that in general, the more educational background that you have, the more in favor you are of diversity. So it might be some of the things you learn in school are building up your capacities of this sort, building up your ability to make more nuanced judgments and things like that, that enable you to deal with more complicated environments. So this is the leg that I think we have less high quality data on, whereas this leg we have just a ton of data. So, just to give you an idea of what some of the consequences of this sort of view is, well, it suggests that some level of social conflict is good for us. We should want social conflict. And part of the value of diversity is in generating conflict. And so rather than thinking that what we want is eliminating conflict, our goal should become figuring out how to make sure our conflicts are productive. So we don't want wars. We don't want pitchforks and torches. But we do want that kind of competitive pressure that comes from being uncomfortable and being around people that you'd like to show up. And so we want ways of generating kind of creative frictions from diversity and cutting off some of the more violent manifestations of opposition to diversity. And part of that means that we need to become more of the sorts of people that are capable of navigating that environment. And so it seems like we can do that. There's evidence that some people are better at this than others. And so part of that is figuring out what can we as a society do to kind of encourage building up those skills. All right, so I'll stop there. Thank you very much.
So one of the arguing is the diversity for diversity in San Diego. Right?
Oh, sure.
Like, there's a, just the act of having a more diverse group of people, by whatever means you yep. go about doing it, is a good unto itself.
Is yep, that that's correct. Yeah. So, this isn't a unique thought to me, so some of my Scott made arguments to this effect on affirmative action in particular. So he's at Michigan, which has a big court case about this, and he wrote an amicus brief to this effect. But yeah, so there's a lot of arguments that just, well, diversity by itself, who cares? It's these other values that we're caring about. No, I think diversity by itself, we should care about it.
And you got that.
Yeah, no, exactly. There's I think, a really easy empirical case to make that diverse, we want diversity for diversity's sake.
How do you find that conflict is more than any other situation? What would you say are the defining aspects of socially acceptable conflict? I mean, this is especially important when you're looking at a college campus such as our own.
Sure.
Which prides itself in diversity.
So can you say that one more sentence?
Sorry. So what defines socially acceptable conflict?
So I think what we want is the sorts of conflict that kind of encourage something like the marketplace of ideas to be very active. So we want conflict in the form of kind of challenging each other intellectually, questioning each other's premises, doubting each other a bit more, that sort of stuff, I think, which is in general pretty successful on a lot of college campuses. We don't want people with tiki torches storming a campus and chatting at people. That's not what we're looking for. But I don't think there's anything wrong, per se, with people identifying with a group and feeling like their group is in a bit of opposition to another one. And that's what makes sports fun to watch. And that's what makes that, like, I mean, that's how our politics are arranged. That stuff isn't necessarily bad. The where it turns sour, where it becomes bad, is when we start deciding that in virtue of your membership of the other group, I ascribe extremely negative views to of you, and I'm going to find opportunities to take advantage of you, and things like that. That's clearly problematic. But if it's just, yeah, your group and my group are rivals, and I want my group to do better, I don't think that's necessarily, so long as better here is, you know, we come up with better arguments or make the cooler gizmo or whatever, that's perfectly fine. But when it turns into, like, I make ascriptions towards you that justify violence or discrimination or something like that, that's a different story.
Do you want to follow up? Is that a you?
Well, I was going to point out some comments on campus that have led to some arguments over what it means to be a diversity, or what it means to be diverse in general, in terms of, if I may, Dr. Earl, about the cafeteria incident.
Oh, sure, yeah.
I'm not sure if you've been offended.
No, it hasn't been involving me.
Okay. We had a couple of students who basically made a social criticism about segregation. It was seen as a hateful kind of situation, although it was meant to be a joke originally. How would you do something like that?
I don't know what the incident was other than that short description, so I don't know if I can comment on it intelligently. I'll do that.
I'm not sure if you're familiar with like confidence levels, like in science studies, it's like the bell curve, and the chunk of the data is in that 90%, like in that big portion of the bell curve, but then you have the outliers, the 5% here and 5% here. And I feel like that 90% of the people that we deal with on a regular basis are people that we have to agree with you and say that diversity is good, but there's 5% on each side, and the left and the right, that are not even willing to try it, or what do you do about the people that have no ability or reason to try to even assimilate themselves in trying diversity?
You know, that's a reasonable question. So what do you do with people that just are going to have none of it? There's not a really good generic answer for that. In part, part because this is a, I mean, this is just a broad political problem, period. So there's, in political philosophy, there's a whole literature on whether or not you should tolerate the intolerant. To what degree do you let them participate in society and try to achieve their social goals and things like that within the rules that everyone else is following? Or do you kind of cleave them off to the side and make sure that they don't infect the population? In a much more detailed account I have in my book, I think that you have to try to tolerate the intolerant. Insofar as you're going to hold liberal values, you have to show them to everybody. Otherwise, it can kind of legitimize their account for why they're being persecuted and not getting the same rules as everybody else. So I think that's it's perfectly fine for someone to advocate that diversity is terrible. I disagree with them, and I have a bunch of reasons for why they're wrong. So long as that stays words, I'm not too worried about it. So long as it turns, if it turns into something else, then we have other mechanisms for elimination of harm that I think are perfectly appropriate. But I agree on this point with John Stuart Mill that they're making bad arguments, and they're giving us the opportunity to show why they're wrong. And we can better understand why we're right when we figure out the arguments against them.
If I may. So interesting. You know, diversity is good in and of itself, but it's also good as a social tool.
Yeah, it's great for things.
But it strikes me that most things that provide social utility, we can engage in an action that actively brings that about. As in, if an educated populace is good, then we engage in actions that actually create an educated populace.
Mm-hmm.
So correct me if I'm wrong, but I think diversity might be different in that because in many instances, we don't want to engage in that for the sake of creating a more diverse population. I'm thinking we're not going to intentionally select embryos to implant that have mild impairments.
Sure. So I mean, like a really easy way of turning up the diversity knob of the policy is let more immigrants into the country.
Sure.
Really straightforward. That's just like a free boost to our economy and a free boost on a bunch of funds. That's really easy. And if we're really worried about it, you can think about immigration policy that makes like a place-oriented visa instead of like a firm-based visa. So you can say like, we want a bunch of new people in Detroit or Buffalo or Utica or whatever, and say, we want different kinds of people so we can specify regions that get certain allotments. That's, and just let people come. And that's, we're in a fortunate position in the United States anyway, of millions of people want to come here. We can use that to our advantage. We can also think about, you know, hiring practices or figuring out how to propose student bodies and all that. Pretty straightforward that you can turn up the diversity dial on any of those things if you want to.
You seem to be talking or referring to diversity mostly in the sense of ethnic, racial, international, maybe linguistic diversity. What about diversity in other ways? Diversity of ability, diversity in gender diversity, sexual orientation diversity. Do you find, or has there been research that shows that those kinds of diversity also have this effect?
So gender diversity, absolutely. There's a bunch of studies on that. Though a lot of them that are using like real world examples of like firm performance are a bit tricky because it turns out that in general, women are better financial managers, period. So financial firms that have more women are better, largely just because they have more women. But yeah, there's pretty robust results around increasing gender diversity, so getting closer to gender parity does better. I haven't seen any empirical work on sexual orientation. That doesn't mean it doesn't exist, but I'd be interested to see what results would look like there. That said, the theoretical work, work that, you know, when I'm doing theoretical work or when others, most notably Scott Page and a couple others, are doing theoretical work. There's no connection in the kind of models themselves. There's no reference to race or sex or sexual orientation or anything like that. It's measured in terms of what's called cognitive diversity. So it's thought of in terms of some big categories. So I focus on what's called perspectival diversity. It's the way you go about seeing the world, how you categorize the stuff in the world, which you can imagine easily can be affected by any of the things you just listed, or by what major you were, or you know, by whether you go to the Red Sox or not. A whole bunch of different kinds of things can generate perspectival diversity, and then just once you have perspectival diversity, you can generate a bunch of positive benefits. So most of the theory work doesn't make any reference to any categorizations, any kind of real classes of people that we think of. It's just these theoretical constructs that map on pretty well, regardless of what the diversity generator is.
So I see that, like how you say, social conflict can create us to have better, like it creates constant stronger like ideas for things because people are being more critical about it. But if like it's natural that more like violent conflicts to come with it, how are we supposed to judge like whether it's worth the like the social conflict that creates better ideas is worth the violent conflict?
So the data on this is actually pretty heavy in the following sense. So if you look at very recent work done on kind of economic and democratic explorations of diversity levels across a lot of countries and across cities, where you look at basically diversity is positively associated with being wealthier, also positively associated with being more democratic. And when you move up the income scale, so way below where the United States is even, diversity at the very low end of the economic scale, so we're like a post-conflict environment, tends to not be very good. It tends to generate a lot of violent conflict. Once you get anywhere close to being a middle-income country and above, which we are way above, diversity is not very positively associated with much violence, and it is positively associated with better quality government, more freedom on most freedom indices that various think tanks develop, and better on democratic scores. So our reason for this, it's not like kind of an arbitrary weird thing, is that the stuff that makes democracy work better, the stuff that makes protection of property rights and things like that work better, is having a bunch of people complain when stuff doesn't go right. And you want to have someone that's not in power complaining, such that there's enough of them that the people in power have to respond. And so the easiest way of doing that is being diverse on a few different fronts. There are going to be more groups that are going to have some reason to complain about the way things are. And so when you have that, you tend to end up with more democratic responsiveness. And then, just in general, the more democratically responsive you are, the less internal violence there is.
So, I have a question as far as culture goes. I guess I'll use France as an example.
Sure.
So, France's culture is very, very important. And one of the things you can look at statistics that will show that, for example, in the $35 worker, make productivity worse, but the country as a whole doesn't particularly care because their culture is more important to them than the positive aspects of changing in various ways. One of the biggest problems, and I just changed my book with the recent election, is that they feel like their culture is being diluted to a certain extent because of the immigration. Like, how would that be? Immigration being the one. How do you make an argument to someone who's clearly shown that they don't care about a lot of the data that you've shown, right? Well, it leads to bad outcomes on a lot of things. And saying, we don't care about the outcomes on those things. Our culture is being kind of diluted or taken away from us, and that is more important than any amount of diversity. How do you make an argument to them, or can you make an argument? Do you feel comfortable making an argument that their culture is
so culture first arguments are tricky. Not for me to argue against, it's tricky for them to hold. And here's why. So David Miller is a prominent culture first anti-immigrationist in the UK. And has launched arguments of like, well, you kind of have this cultural patrimony, you should have some say in whether it gets to be furthered in the same way as like, we don't think the people should like burn down museums. Culture writ large, in the more popular sense, is dependent on the people that are in that culture and things like that. The problem with that is like, new people are constantly coming into France and the UK. They're being displaced. And it's not even immigrants. We could shut down immigration tomorrow, and the culture is going to be different. Just because new people are born and have different ideas and are exposed to other views on the internet and all that kind of stuff. So there's a real limit to how much you can kind of control. Like there's a French agency for coming up with French words for things. So it's not like an American word. And like they're starting to realize they're just fighting an uphill battle. People call it the internet, and people call it like a camera. They don't call it apparatus, so all that sort of stuff. They just on that front, they're just not going to succeed. The trouble is like, I mean, on this front, France has a bunch of problems with things like the 35-hour work week, namely like. Youth unemployment in France is like 25%. Non-white unemployment is like 40%. There's just no way that's a stable environment. That's a sign of kind of rot. Like they need to do something about that. The other flippant thing I would say with France is, well, don't invade and colonize countries if you don't want people like that around.
I love
France. I used to live there. It's great. But there's a really interesting line a few years ago from a labor minister in Germany that was, so Germany and France have had a labor shortage problem of the sort. But they just need workers, so they get people in on worker visas. And in Germany's case, it was. A lot of Tunisians and things like that. And the quote was something like, we ask for workers and we got people. We got people that had families and cultures and different tastes and all that kind of stuff. And so one great thing out of Germany is we got like the kebab sandwich, which is one of the most delicious things on earth. Which was Turkish immigrants in Germany, but a bunch of continental Europe has a really problematic relationship with immigration for a bunch of reasons. And there's not like, there's so many different policy moves between continental Europe and the United States that I think it's hard to make a good comparison very cleanly, because our labor market is vastly different than theirs and a whole bunch of other things. That said, the other part, I know this is a very long response, and I apologize. Some of this depends on the idea that like, all culture comes down to like individual preferences, where it's assuming that like I like a certain set of things, and so when I move to a new place, my stable preference set will continue on there. But lots of stuff is social norms. And social norms are going to change for you when you're in a new environment around new kinds of people. So people are pretty good at realizing there's a lot of cool things about French culture, and they adopt those things, right? They have some of their own things also, but they adopt most of French culture. There's really not a problem of, not that strong of a problem of assimilation. So I used to live in Marseille, which is the most diverse city in France by far. And I had a funny experience when I was there for about a month before a French friend of mine said, oh, just never cross this street. Because once you go over there, it just gets super dangerous. It's like, oh, you mean my favorite part of town? Where stores are open on the weekend and they're open past 4:30. And it's like, people are very friendly once they realize I'm not French. It's great. There really are serious social conflicts that are non-trivial. But I think some of the worries are just massively overblown. Yeah. I was confused about it.
One of the issues that people could have with diversity is that they don't understand the other cultures coming into their country. So what can be done to help people understand those other cultures and beliefs?
So again, I think some of this is just contact. So there's a sociologist named Gordon Allport that developed what's called the Allport contact hypothesis that basically says, in the most simple form, the more you're around people that are different, the more you end up liking people that are different. This empirically bears out under a few conditions. It usually has to be you're engaged in something where you're seen as on the same side, so like you're on the same team in a sport or something like that, or your roommates in your dorm. You kind of work together on something that works out. When that happens, really systematically, you come to just like people that are different. There's also another work that offers more kind of economic innovation. So port cities are historically extremely diverse and extremely challenged. And the main reason that people speculate on that is just there's money to be made in dealing with people that are different from you if you're in a trade-oriented city. So there's a really cool paper that looks at this in detail in India, looking at port cities compared to similarly sized cities that are landlocked, so non-port environments. And religious violence is way lower, even though there's more inter-religious contact, I should say. But basically the idea is if I'm a Hindu guy and you're a Muslim guy, I have my Hindu contacts that I can trade between, but I can only make so much money there because everyone has access to the same goods as me. And likewise for you with your Muslim contacts. But if you don't have access to my Hindu contacts and vice versa, and so there's a lot of money to be made if we can figure out how to get along. And so that's, in general, there's those sort of added rules like that. And I think in general it's explained by trade. So tolerance goes up in trade-oriented kind of places. So the more reason you have to bump into people and talk to them, the more you find out. Right? So I think the really simple answer to this, really simple, is like, cut down on segregation. Make it so you have to bump into people that are different from you, and then you find out that they're interesting and nice. Is the answer.
And what about social community
diversity in a lot of different countries? Can you just touch on it, I'm sorry.
Social community diversity in a lot of different countries,
so the idea people can hear was just, well, if we just keep intermixing, intermarrying, and all this, eventually we're all just going to be like one kind of mud race. Conveniently, we're awesome at coming up with new ways of dividing ourselves up. This is just not a problem. We're fantastic at it. We always come up with new things to fight about. It's delightful. Very strikingly, according to some Pew research from about 6 months ago, we're way more okay with our son or daughter marry someone of a different race, but we're way less okay with our son or daughter marrying someone of a different political party. We're really, really against it. Something like 90% of people wouldn't approve of that. We're way more willing to accept an in-law of a different race than we are of a different political party. That wasn't true 20 years ago. You can think of other things, sports fandom or academic discipline or whatever. We're really good at coming up with new ways of dividing ourselves up. I don't think that's going to stop.
Any other questions? Oh, please join me in thanking, first of all,